علي will bear witness that nothing deserves to be worshipped except Allah. He will bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Allah's messenger and his slave servant. I want to begin this khutbah with a supplication to Allah. Every one of you here today needs something from Allah. I don't know what it is, but Allah knows. So therefore I begin with this dua, Allahumma inni a'udhubika min ilm la yanfa'u. Oh Allah, I seek refuge with you from knowledge that don't benefit. It is my sincere dua today that what you hear from Allah and His Messenger will definitely benefit you. Today I want all of us, including myself, to check our iman. How is your iman? Because the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, said, "Al-mu'minu qayru khayrun wa hafidhullah min al-mu'minu da'if wa fi kulli khayr." A strong believer is better and more loved by Allah than a weak believer, but there's good in all of them. So no matter how deep, how great, how big, how small our iman is, there's something good. But we don't want to be the same way. We want to make sure that we have strong iman. Why? To live and navigate in this world that we live in. I'm going to base this khutbah on an ayah from Quran. تبارك الذي بيده الملك ولا كل شيء قدير الذي خلق الناس والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا هو العزيز الغفور. Blessed be in him in whose hand is the dominion of the heavens and the earth, Allah, who created life and death to test you. So we're tested. We're tested every day. But what's the level of your iman? It's very practical. In this famous hadith, the Prophet ﷺ told us that the angel Jibril came to the Prophet as a human being and said, Ya Muhammad, akhbirni an al-Islam. Explain to me what Islam is. And the Prophet explained what Islam is. You know the hadith. And then he said, أخبرني عن الإيمان. What is Iman? And so today we want to talk. You all know. You're Muslims. And you believers. But how deep is your Iman? You're going to find out. And تؤمن بالله. Okay? Let's name them. Believe in Allah. Do you believe in Allah? I don't mean do you believe in the existence of Allah? Because Shaitan knows more than us that Allah exists. Think about it. We have never seen one prophet. We believe in the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him. We never saw him. Shaitan did. In fact, Shaitan has seen every prophet that ever existed. He knows the scripture. He knows. This is why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks the man, Allah tells you that it's a multiple. Why didn't you bow down? Why didn't you bow down to my man, Adam, that I created? Why didn't you bow down? He said, I'm a khairu minhu, I'm better than him. Khalaqtaniha. You created me. You know, atheist. Shaitan knows. You created me. I and him you create. I'm better than him. So, by the way, no one explains Shaitan, the devil, Satan, better than Muslims. Christians say that the Satan, the devil, is a fallen angel. It's a mistake. That's why Allah said in the Quran, مَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created the jinn and the human beings except to worship me. He don't mention angels. Why doesn't he mention angels? Don't angels worship Allah? Of course they do. But the difference between the human being and the jinn, Allah gave us free choice. Angels have no free choice. They worship Allah. Whatever Allah tells them to do, they do. But human beings and jinn is different. So this, I have a theory that, that at least was perhaps potentially the greatest jinn ever. Why? Allah gave the commandment to every angel, bow down to Adam. And they all bow down together. I want you to try to see that picture in the universe, all those billions and trillions of angels at one time bowing down to Adam. But at least, out of angels, the jinn bow down. He wouldn't do it. If Allah is only telling at least of all the jinn, only telling him, one jinn, to bow down to Adam, it tells him something about at least, potentially. But in his disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he becomes the shaitan. So Allah said, give me some time, respite me until the day they raise up. He knows! Yawm al-Qiyamah, he knows! I can show you ayahs from Quran, I can show you hadith. Let me give you one hadith and then one ayah from the Quran. It's not my topic, by the way. I haven't started. So I hope you all got a little bit of time. We'll be brushing it. We're doing like this, right? So every time you go like that, I see you. So, you know, when you get a chance, I want you to read Muslim Hadith, volume number 1, in the chapter 4, Kitab al-Iman. And in that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us about shaitan. Whenever a verse in the Quran about making sujood is in the Quran, and we human beings prostrate to Allah, shaitan, he sees this, and he goes away in seclusion, saying, woe is with me. I was given the commandment to bow down to Adam, and I refused. They bow down to Adam, فَلَهُ جَنَّةً, for them is Jannah. وَلِي and no. He knows. He doesn't not know, but the question is, why he doing all this evil? Why? One reason and one reason only. It's in the Quran. So that he can have some companions in the fire. Misery loves company. That's it. His whole thing, he knows he's going to be Habidina Fiha Abada. Whatever, he's in it, he's cursed. He can't help himself. But he was given a free choice. Like you and I have a free choice. Today I'm asking the question, what's your trial? I know what your trial is. I know what my trial is. What's your trial? Because we all, Allah created us to test us. Everything is a test. What's your test? Some people test drugs. That's their problem. They got a drug problem. Some people even cigarettes. Let me tell you something about cigarettes. I don't want any of you to think that cigarettes is halal. Every Islamic group, every scholar, say smoking cigarettes is haram. By the way, the World Health Organization said, if the nations of the world do nothing about it by the end of the 21st century, 1 billion people would have died as a result of smoking cigarettes. I'm walking a block away from my masjid. Whenever I'm walking, I'm always looking around. I'm always security. And about 50 yards in front of me, I see 5 Muslim young men. And each one of them smoking cigarettes. Of course, they can't see me. But I predicted what's going to happen when I get close. When they see me, they're going to throw away the cigarette. It always happens. And they did. I came, I said, Assalamu alaikum. And I continued walking. What they did is consciousness of guilt. If cigarettes are okay, why are you hiding? If you were drinking water, you could continue drinking water. Why are you throwing away when I come? So my question to you, what is your trial? Some of our trial is money. We love money and do anything for money. Some of our trial is women. Some men.
Where's your trial?
Because you've got to be careful, because your trial can take you out.
There are lots of other ones that are going to be tested. Let me give you one person that his trial is there for the whole world to see. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And when we tested Ibrahim, and he passed every test, he's a model for us. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam is a model for us. Have you ever heard of the model of the Marines? The few. Wow. You want to hear something about the few? Go back thousands of years ago. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam has a conversation with his wife Sarah. Nobody's around but Allah. He knows everything. He hears everything. And this is what he said. Yeah, Sarah. Laysa al-wajhi mukmin ghaydi wa ghaydi kiki. Oh, Sarah, there is not one believer on the face of the earth other than you. Not one believer on the face of the earth other than you and me. Allah bless us. We got Muslims now. In New York City, 1,300,000 Muslims, 35 full-time Muslim schools, thousands of Muslim businesses. We got people. For him and Sarah, only 2 people on the face. But Allah, yes, he does. To find out who you are. To find out who you are. You're not who you say you are. Ooh, you are as a result of your test, your trial. How did you do in your trial, your test? How did you do? How are you doing? And don't tell me what you did last week. Don't tell me what you did last year. Don't tell me what you've been doing all your years. My question is, what is your faith like now? Because we can lose it. Like that, we can lose it. Something could take us off. I'll just fast forward for a moment. People, my name is Scott. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a pass. And one day he came to son Ismail and said, Allah has ordered me to build this house. Will you help me? I want you to think about this. He said, yes, of course. Think about this, right? Here comes Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, his wife, Hagar, and the newborn baby, Ismail. And he places Ismail down and some water and some dates, and he begins to walk away. Hagar follows him. Ibrahim! Anitetep! Ibrahim! Anitetep! Oh, Abraham, where are you going? Where are you going? Are you going to leave me alone? And he doesn't turn around to keep on going. And she says, isn't Allah ordering you to do this? He said, yes. And then she said, Allah will never neglect us. Nobody, no human being, nobody around is Hagar and a little baby Ismail. The word is gone, the dates are gone. But now she's proactive now. She trusts Allah, but she's proactive, and she starts looking around, and she's going between herself and her mother looking for somebody, and she hears something. And behold, she looks. Is the angel Jibril digging his heels in the earth, and the water comes. Think about this. Abraham comes later, alayhi salatu wasalam, Ismail is born, he helps the people. There are a few people between. How many of you made Hajj or Umrah? Raise your hand. Look around. Do you know the most expensive building in the world? That's the house. $100 million. In that place where there was nobody, now thousands of planes flying to Mecca. Thousands of buses flying to Mecca. 4,400 men cleaned that masjid every day. Over 5,000 bathrooms. Impressed? Hotels all around. You've been to some of those hotels. Move and Pick and the others. Thousands of people. Thousands of businesses. Because of one commandment. alayhi salatu wasalam, to build his house. So my question to you today is, what's your test? You trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I don't care whatever your test is, you will pass. And then go to Jannah. Let me give you a quick picture of Jannah, and then I sit down and try to pursue inshallah if I can. I'm not swearing that I'm gonna be able to finish in 10, 15 minutes. I don't know. I'll try. But I'm giving the Imam permission, so I'm getting it. The Imam needs to give a lot of love. So let me finish this off with this. Check them out. Believing Allah is being stopped from other things. Prophet alayhi salat wa salam said to the wife Aisha radhiallahu anha, Ya Aisha, hadha Jibril yaqra'uki yaqra'u alayhi salam. Here is the angel Jibril, give you salam. This is what Aisha said. Alayhi salam wa rahmatullah tara mala'ara. Peace and blessing be upon him, from the Messenger of Allah. You see what I don't see. You believe in angels. Why? Because that's Iman. You believe in angels. Even though we don't see them, they're here right now. As I'm speaking, right now, they're angels here. Right now, in this masjid, there's angels right around you. You can't see them, but we believe in them. And tu'mina billahi wa malaikati wa kutubihi. We believe in the scriptures. Wa anzalat Torah wa injil. And Allah said, we sent the Torah and the injil. We don't have a problem with you saying that the Torah is from Allah, it's from Allah. At-Torah, fiha hudan wa nur. The Torah in it is guidance and light. And the Injil, fihi hudan wa nur. And the Injil, the gospel, is guidance and light. So we believe. So we believe in the prophets, in the scriptures, Rusul. We believe in all the prophets. We believe in all of them. Yom al-Akhir. Ah. Yom al-Akhir. I feel sorry for people who don't believe in the hereafter. What about you? Okay. The Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, said, إِذَا دَخَلَ الْأَحْلُ جَنَّةِ جَنَّةِ جِنَّةِ جِنَّةِ إِنَّ لَكُمْ أَنْ أَحْيَا لَكُمْ تَعْلَمُ. And when the people enter Jannah, and I hope every one of you and your family enter Jannah, when we enter Jannah, a caller will call out and say, it is for you to live and never die. But not now. Kullu nafsin zaa'iqatul maut, and so shall die. We know we're going to die. But after Jannah, we're not going to die. By the way, brothers, let me tell you something. As a speaker, when you keep looking at your watch, I see it. So don't look at your watch. Okay, I'm going to let you out. It's for you to be healthy and never sick. Do you know, according to World Health Organization, 95% of the people have ailments. More than one third have more than five ailments. Brother, my master said, Imam Siraj, I take 29 different medications a day. 29. The way it is, everybody gets sick, but not now. Now we get it, and a Jannah, no more sick. The last one. And for shikma, for you to be young and never grow old again. Believe in your man. Now let me say Qadra, and then I still do it. What do you mean the Qadra of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? In this hadith, relayed by Atiyah ibn Abi Rabah, Tabi'een, living at the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, he came to Mecca, and he met Ibn Abbas. And Ibn Abbas said, shall I not show you a woman from Jannah? He said, yes. And he said,
this black woman,
she had epilepsy. She came to the Prophet, peace and blessings, and said, Ya Rasulullah, I have epilepsy. And when I have a fit, then I'm uncovered. She said, can you make dua for me? And Allah was, sure.
And the Prophet, peace and blessings, gave a very interesting response. He said, if you would be patient, let you gender, you have gender. But if you wish, I make dua, then Allah heals you. She said, I'll be patient.
For years, I asked myself the question,
why the Prophet doesn't make dua for me?
I didn't get it. I didn't understand. And one day, I got it. I did some research. How many people on this earth have epilepsy?
50 million. 50 million people on this earth have epilepsy.
The Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, is not here to make dua for anything. But if you understood the acceptance of the Prophet of Allah is rewarding.
Give you one example.
Give you one example. The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, the Prophet said that Allah asks the angels, and by the way, whenever Allah asks a question, he doesn't ask the question because he don't know the answer. He asks the question to teach the lesson. Allah asks the angels of death, did you take the life of the beloved of my servant? Yaquluna na'am, yes. This is what Allah says. When you took the life of that baby, of that woman who loved that baby, that child who was loved by his father, what did they say? The Quluna, they said, Hamidaka Mustanja. Allah, they praised you. They said, from Allah we come, from Allah we come. Allah, forgive me the accusations of gender. Build for my slave a house in Jannah and call it a house of praise. What am I saying? That when you believe in the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it don't mean that you don't do anything. You make effort. But the belief in that, the acceptance of that, changes the whole thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the reward. What he gives us, So brothers and sisters, I say to you as I sit down, all of us are going to be tested. We're going to be tested every day. Right now, with this economy for some people, when I look at the condition of black people, Martin Luther King Jr. was right. He who gets behind in a race must forever remain behind the one faster than the man who runs. I've been to so many matches around the country. I've been to almost every African-American match. And when I look at the difference between the African-American matches, including my own, compared to some of the immigrant matches, I ask myself the question, why is that? I'll give an example. I did a fundraiser for a master student in Memphis, Tennessee, for his school, Pleasant View School. You know how much we raised in the funding at night? $950,000. What fundraiser do you know any African American raised that kind of money? $950,000. I go to most fundraisers in Africa last week. Roughly $10,000, $15,000. So, why is it that? You can never understand the trauma that African Americans are facing over the years. You know what? You have to get past that. It was the Prophet of Allah, yes, in slavery, all of that, Jim Crowism, all of that. But even despite that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made us Muslims. And when He made us Muslims, He gave us everything. Now what we have to do as Muslims, in my opinion, is to now go out into society and spread this message. I close with this with a confession. It's a confession. Confession of Imam Salah. most of us are converts. Our parents were Muslims. How many of you converts raised? Okay. That's most one of us. How blessed we are, first generation. Now we have a legacy. We have children and grandchildren. What will we leave behind for them? I was in a group for Nation of Islam. You were. And after 1975, when we learned what Islam was, we realized that wasn't Islam. It's no question about it. But I wonder this. Why was it that we were in an organization that wasn't Islam, didn't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, didn't believe in Prophet Muhammad, all of that? I asked myself, one day I had a conversation with myself, why is it that when you were in the Nation of Islam, you quit your job to sell a 25-50? Why is it that you went to do the project by yourself and knocking on doors, thousands of doors? Why is it that your customers invited you into the house, invited you to their funerals, their graduations, their weddings, the relationships that you had? Why is it that you can talk to the people and bring all the people into the temple? And now we have the truth. What is it? A young sister, immigrant sister, said, given a talk, and she said something like, 70% of the new Muslims go back to disbelief. And my first question, how do you know that? And then I asked this question. How many non-Muslims leave the fold of Islam? The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, came up to him. He said, you will follow those who came before, step by step and inch by inch, so that if they fall in a hole of a lizard, you follow them behind. Are there Muslims leaving the fold of Islam? My dua today is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us not die except as a Muslim. I pray Allah the Almighty help us to pass our tests, ever they are, as individual and as collective. I pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless this masjid. Man, have an impact in this area and in this city. I pray Allah the Almighty that the Muslims will join their hearts together, their hands together, their programs together to make an impact on the society. I ask Allah the Almighty to help our children sustain this deen, to love this deen. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَاخِذْنَا إِنْ نَسِينَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا رَبَّنَا وَلَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْنَا إِصْرًا كَمَا حَمَلْتَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِنَا ربنا لا تحملنا ما لا طاقه لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا وانت مولانا فاصبرنا على الصبر يا رب.